Beautician by occupation, who comes with chief complaints of tortuous veins over the left lower limb since 4 years and pain over the left lower limb since 4 years. Patient was apparently asymptomatic 4 years ago when she noticed dilated tortuous veins over the left leg, insidious in onset, and it gradually progressed. It's become more prominent since the last 1 year and also noted to be prominent towards the end of the day. The aggravating factors include a long walk, and the relieving factors is lying down. Patient also notices pain in the inner aspect of her left lower limb since 4 years. It's dull aching in nature and persistent. The aggravating factors are it aggravates towards the end of the day and standing after a long walk, and relieving factors is by lying down. There's no other significant positive history. Past history, not a known case of systemic hypertension, diabetes mellitus, coronary artery disease, bronchial asthma or epilepsy. She has a history of previous two LSES done 7 and 10 years ago, no history of prolonged bread rest, and no history of similar complaints in the past. There's no significant personal history. There's no similar complaints in the family members. Her obstructive history, her last menstrual period is on 10th of October 2019. She has regular monthly cycles, 4 days, 28-day cycle. No complaints of dysmenorrhea, excessive menstrual flow. She survived by 2 children born via LSES 7 and 10 years ago. No similar complaints during pregnancy. There's no history of OCP intake. On summarizing the history, a 32-year-old female who's a beautician by occupation came with complaints of tortuous veins over the inner aspect of her left leg since 4 years, associated with dull aching pain. Both the tortuosity as well as the pain are noted to aggravate on prolonged standing and relieved on lying down.
Just to interrupt you with a couple of questions. You did say there is no history of prolonged rest, no history of similar episodes during pregnancy. So what are you actually looking for by asking this history or trying to get?
Ma'am, pregnancy is a physiological condition causing varicose veins, ma'am. So we want to load any similar complaints during pregnancy and no history.
So why does it cause physiologically?
Obstruction of the deep veins, ma'am.
How? Why?
Gravid uterus causing compression of the iliac veins.
It's not a permanent obstruction. You can't call it obstruction. It's better to say compression of the on the large veins by the gravid uterus can cause some dilatation and physiologically. What is the other reason why in pregnancy the veins get dilated?
Progesterone effect, ma'am.
That's what you should say first.
Smooth muscle relaxation.
So the vessels get distended. The female in pregnancy more than, see, the gravid uterus coming and passing is close to term. But earlier itself, people start getting this symptomatology because the effects of progesterone is on that. So it causes a relaxation of smooth muscles of the blood vessels. So that is the reason.
Yes.
Put your first slide, please. Dilated tortuous veins on the left leg.
Yes, ma'am.
On the medial aspect and or the posterior aspect?
On
where?
The inner aspect, ma'am.
What do you mean by inner aspect of leg?
On the medial aspect of the leg, ma'am.
No, no, even in description also he have put that word.
Middle, okay.
Moving to general examination. Patient is conscious, cooperative, well-oriented to time and place and person. This patient is moderately built and nourished. No pallor, no ictus, no cyanosis, no clubbing, no generalized lymphadenopathy, no pedal edema, JVP is not raised, vital signs. Pulse rate is 82 per minute, felt in the right radial artery, regular rhythm, good volume, no radio delay or no radiofemoral delay. Blood pressure is 130 bar 80 millimeter of mercury, measured in right arm in supine position. Respiratory rate is 16 per minute, patient is afebrile. Local examination, inspection of the left lower limb, dilated and tortuous veins seen over the medial aspect of the ankle, medial and posterior medial aspect of the leg, extending up to the medial aspect of the upper part of the thigh of the left lower limb. There is no ankle flare, no pigmentation in the ankle region, no skin ulceration is seen, no edema, no redness or stretched skin, no scars, no loss of hair, no brittle nails. Morrissey's cough impulse was not seen. Attitude of the limb was normal, gait was normal. Inspection of the right lower limb, no prominent weight seen. Palpation of the left lower limb, there is no localized warmth, no tenderness. Brody Tenderlenburg test 1 is positive, Brody Tenderlenburg 2 test was also positive. Multiple tourniquet test, the perforator incompetence is seen at the mid-thigh, below knee and above the ankle level. Modified Perthes test, veins become less prominent on asking the patient to walk. Morrissey's cough impulse is positive. Fagan's test, facial defects noted below the knee level and above ankle and in the mid-leg. Peripheral pulsations are normal in both the lower limbs. No thickening of the skin seen, no deformity, no sensory loss. Range of movements is normal. Percussion, Schwartz test, no impulse is felt. Auscultation, no bruit heard, no inguinal nodes are palpable. The right lower limb is appearance normal. So clinical pictures. Demonstration of tendon abductors. Other system examination, perabdomen, no dilated veins seen, no mass palpable. The cardiovascular system is normal. Respiratory system, bilateral air entry present, no added sounds. Central nervous system, no focal neurological deficit. Digital examination was normal. Pervaginal examination was normal. Diagnosis, primary varicose vein in the left lower limb involving the great saphenous system with mid-thigh, below knee and above ankle perforated incontinence without any complications. CAP classification. C2S, etiology is EP, anatomy is S and S, AP, pathology is PR. Reflex.
Now I just want to ask you, why did you do a Schwartz test on this patient?
Sir, I could see the column of veins, so...
Yeah, there's a column of vein, but where to where? That is important when you do a Schwartz test. If there's no column of vein, see, as you go up, unless there is a vein extending up to the saphenous opening, you will do a Schwartz test, you will not be able to, because the fascia and the thigh will compress the ringlet. No impulse will be transmitted. So you've done a Schwartz test. Posterior, this should not do like that.
Yes.
Understand?
Yes,
that's
sir.
Very important on those point.
Yes.
Understand?
Yes, sir.
And then, what about the scarf impulse? Morris says, how will you know?
After emptying the veins and asking the patient to lie in supine position, after emptying the veins and keeping the lip in the neutral position, ask the patient to cough, we can see for an impulse at the SFG.
Do you get it?
Some impulse was there.
Because I already emptied the vein. There must be some flow into the vein, come into the vein, no cough, it must be not show. And SFJ, Brody Tendenberg 1 is positive. If Brody Tendenberg test 1 is positive, you should understand to the extent of causing a Morrissey's calf impulse positive and the Schwartz test positive, then the column of vein should extend up to the saphenous opening. It should not be somewhere to the mid thigh. That is where we miss things. Radiologically, this SFJ will be positive. If you do a sonogram, I hope you have done a sonogram on this Doppler, and that you have shown a SFJ incompetence. But clinical incompetence, I still have my own doubts on that, because very difficult. When a clinical impairment is broadly 10 and above 10, one is to be done. I'm at least clear, I'm under the impression that it should always have a column of vein going up to the saphenous opening. That is why when you release, you can see the blood dropping down. Half the thigh, if the blood is not there, and then you're coming to only broadly 10 and 2 positive. Understand? So these two things points you should know.
Auscultation, there is no bruit in vein. Only arterial.
No bruit. AV malformation, you can hear a hum.
When will you suspect AV malformation? No, for argument's sake, when will you actually look for AV malformation? Obviously, patient will complain only of dilated veins, like this lady. How old is she?
32.
So, can you suspect an AV malformation in this lady? Or
when will you suspect an AV malformation in a lady? What will be the effect of AV malformation?
What will be the effect if there's an AV malformation in that limb?
Earlier age of presentation along with unilateral...
No, patient will have a gigantism. Then you should suspect the varicose vein and other things with the navy malformation. A local gigantism with the finger or the whole limb gigantism will be there when you have a navy malformation. So you should not say AV malformation.
So there'll be local judge.
And Wayne never talk about a bruhi. Please, it's very, very beautifully systematized. If there's an arterial thing, you have a bruhi. Wayne, it's only a musical hum. You have, see, it's very, the terminologies have been very well described, so you should not misplace the terminologies, which will land you in complications. Understand? Yes.
So if you mention things like this, you will go into pathways where you may get a little confused, or you're very good at AV malformation, you can answer all the questions. It's very good. But the terminology is incorrect. So better to say, no, venous hum could be appreciated on auscultation. Okay? And so abdomen, you had mentioned the findings. So what exactly do you expect to see in the abdomen in a lady with a varicose veins?
Look for abdominal, any abdominal.
Adjust the mic, please. Yeah.
Look for any abdominal mass is present or not.
Where exactly?
Pelvic mostly.
Should be very specific. Epigastric mass very rarely can cause DVT and varicose veins, like the last case, CA stomach. But you should always look for essentially a mass in the pelvis that is compressing the veins, like your friend said. So be very specific.
Two things in a patient with varicose vein you must not forget, in a male and a female. If, because you are thinking in abdomen as a component may cause a retrograde thing. In a male, if there's some mass which you are not able to bear, but you should be very wary about the varicocele. You must see for a varicocele in a patient in a male, and a female, because if there's going to be a higher vaporization, you must see for vulval varicocities. A component of varicocele in a female is a vulval varicocities. So these two things, as a undergraduate, doesn't matter. But as a postgraduate, if you are going to look into the abdomen, you must have this an idea that there could be a renal vein problem or a malignant sacral malignancy causing a varicose vein and an obstruction or infiltration to the IVC. So with that view only we should see. Understand? Yes.
Why did you do a PV examination for this patient? PV and PR?
Ma'am, patient is female patient, so rule out any pelvic inflammatory disease, pelvic congestion syndrome. So there will be tenderness.
It's an isolated case of varicose vein. A patient is... She's not pregnant.
Any deposits or other things you have to be secondary ability which are not able to do, then fine. But otherwise, an inflammatory disease is going to cause this, you know, it's not going compatible with your diagnosis, is it not? Yes.
So varicose veins essentially will be a short case in your MS exam, right? So you'll be given 10 minutes, max 15 minutes. So if you have any abdominal findings, say you found some pelvic mass, then yes, you should do a pervaginal examination and a PR. Yes, but your abdomen examination is normal. You don't have any other history suggestive of some other pathology. Yes, no need to waste your time doing a PV and a PR. So you have to have that degree of judgment. Quickly, what should I do, what I should not do and waste my time? Because time given is very precious. You have to take a quick history, examine. So you should get that practice. So unnecessary things, don't go into territories that are not required.
So the three P's in varicose vein in female: pregnancy, pelvic tumors, and pills.
Pills.
We have to search.
Okay, how will you investigate this patient? You have given a nice classification. So how will you investigate? How will you manage? Quickly, then we'll go to the next case.
To confirm the diagnosis, we'll do a duplex scan of both lower limbs, ma'am.
Sorry?
Duplex scan of both right and left lower limb. Then I'll do an ultrasound abdomen to look for any intrapelvic lesions or that.
Why you want this duplex scan?
Sir, I can grade the whether there is a incomplete is or not.
It has two components, sir. One is a B-mode ultrasound as well as
the
color.
Why you want? See, in varicose vein, what is essentially we need to know?
Whether it's a reflex disease.
Location of the perforators.
What is the most important information you look for in any doctor report?
Already you have diagnosed SFJ, you have diagnosed perforator incompetence. So your sonar or duplex is not going to make much difference.
He said that.
A deep vein thrombus. That is what is essential. And why do you want it for the right limb?
I am external examiner. So I'm going to be quiet most of the times. Tell me, when you ask for duplex scan, what is your aim?
First thing is to locate the lesions, whether SFJ incompetence is there or not.
What is a condition in the veins of the leg which will prevent any surgical or
deep vein thrombosis.
So that is your first aim, correct? Now, considering that the deep veins are normal, now you will start contemplating treatment, not conservative, but intervention. That comes as a second thing. So what are the things that you're looking for in a duplex scan, considering that deep veins are normal?
Location of perforators.
Yes.
Then
competent perforators or incompetent perforators?
Cephalofemoral junction competency, sir. SFJ
incompetence. See, the first test, listen, it has to come logically. What is the first test that you do?
Brody-Trendelenburg
test. What are the components of Brody-Trendelenburg test?
So one and two. One will be a reversal flow.
So Brody-Trendelenburg test one is for SFJ incompetence.
SF junction. So when you answer results of your duplex scan, what is the first thing that you should tell me?
To localize SFJ incompetence.
SFJ incompetence. Second thing in Trendelenburg's test, what do you do?
To look for multiple perforators along the vein, sir.
Incompetent perforators. So that is the second thing that. So see, when you send the patient for an investigation, the sonologist or the radiologist, whoever is doing the scan, should know. He may not know what is Brody-Trendelenburg test. You will have to tell him that, look, I want you to look at the SF junction. First, I want you to look at the deep vein. Then I want you to look at the cephalofemoral junction. Then I want you to look at incompetent perforators. That is what is going to tell you how to go about treating the patient. So what you have done in clinical examination is followed by an investigation to prove it. Clear? So what you have talked there should come here. You cannot go here and there. Okay. Moment you say you are going to look for incompetent perforators as the first thing, the examiner is going to come back at you. You understand? It tells the examiner that you are not focused towards treating this patient at all. Okay. So everything has to go in one after another. I do not know anatomy of Chennai that much, but if you are traveling by metro from one place to another, you should know each station that the thing is going to stop. That's the way you go about.
Okay, last line. Okay, you have found SFJ incompetence, perforator incompetence. There is no DVT on your duplex. What is the treatment you're going to offer? And then we'll go to the next case. Last question.
Trendelenburg procedure. With stripping off veins.
Fully you have to tell, no? You have to address all the components.
Flesh ligation of juxtafemoral, SFJ, at the SFJ. Then ligating the main three named tributaries.
It's called subfacial ligation of perforator incompetence. Okay. Flesh ligation of greater saphenous vein with the perforator subfacial ligation.
My suggestion again, treatment of varicose veins surgically or interventionally, the principles have remained the same. So when there is multimodality treatment which achieves the same result, the effort on your part should be to give the latest of the treatment. But it may hurt an examiner, okay, because you are not telling surgical. So the best way is to tell the principle of my treatment will be stopping of the flow at, say, SF junction or perforator, etc., and treatment of the dilated tortuous main vein. The options in front of me are, number one, Trendelenburg's operation, number two, laser ablation, whatever the treatments are. Okay, it makes things very clear because there are multiple types of examiners. One will be wanting operation, the second will be wanting laser. You don't know what is going to happen. So it's much better to remain in an area which satisfies both. That is the way you escape multimodality treatments. Okay.
Just tell all, what are the multimodality treatment in few words? One is surgery, next is sclerotherapy, then
radiofe.
Intravenous laser ablation.
RFA.
RFA. But there are criteria for each of those also. Understand? You cannot pass a probe with a vein which is very dilated and tortuous. You have a straight length of vein in the earlier stages, only you can do an RFA. If it's dilated and tortuous, you cannot push in a cable into and do it. It's very cumbersome. You can't do that. Okay. Let me go to the next case. Time is up.
Before you go on to the next case, I've got only one. Madam, you possibly will never get varicose veins. Why? You. Because you have been standing on your toes all the time.
Okay, you did well. All the best.
Thank you.
We'll go.